Rights of Third Parties Bill.
We now resume the second reading debate on the Statute of Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014. The Honourable Yiu-chung, Chairman of the Bills Committee on the above bill, will address the Council on the Committee's report. Mr. Yiu-chung. President, as Chairman of the Statute Law Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014, I now report on the deliberations of the Bills Committee. The bill is an omnibus bill and comprises 15 parts and proposes miscellaneous and technical amendments to various ordinances and subsidiary legislation. The Bills Committee and the Administration has held a total of 4 meetings to scrutinize the bill. Members do not have any objection to the proposed amendments in various parts. Members note that Part 2 of the bill proposes to repeal and amend provisions in the Crimes Ordinance relating to homosexual offences involving area which were ruled unconstitutional by the court in 2006 and 2007. Some members note that as the government has all along not amended the Crimes Ordinance, many homosexual persons and even frontline police officers have misunderstood that the relevant provisions are still valid. The administration explained that since the handing down of the judgment, the police and the Department of Justice have not laid any charges based on these provisions. The administration has also reminded frontline police officers that these provisions no longer have any legal effect. As for other existing provisions under Crimes Ordinance, which are gender-specific or discriminatory on the ground of sexual orientation, the administration advised that the review of sexual offences subcommittee of the Law Reform Commission is reviewing in phases laws on sex and related offences. The BC notes that the CA Communications Authority has encountered certain enforcement difficulties in performing its functions. So the government proposes amendments to the Unsolicited Electronic Messages Ordinance, UEMO, to the effect that a specified notice issued by the CA may be served on a person in addition to registered post by other means like ordinary post to the person. Members also discussed with the administration the presumption clauses on successful delivery and the feasibility of serving the notice by electronic means. Another proposal deliberated at length by the BC is Section 8 relating to the proposals to amend the Trade Descriptions Ordinance. The administration proposes to amend certain defense provisions following the judgment of the Court of Final Appeal on a case to the effect that the provisions should be read down as imposing merely an evidential burden on the accused, with the persuasive burden remaining throughout on the prosecution. Members and the Bills Committee's legal advisor have raised different opinions on whether Section 52, bracket 2, and Section 54 and the revised draft of these sections will adequately reflect the policy intent. After consideration, the administration advised that the drafting format of Section 52 to Section 54 is consistent with the drafting of similar provisions in the ordinance. So to maintain consistency of the various provisions and a response to CFA's judgment, the administration would not make substantial changes to the drafting of Sections 52 to Section 54. The details of the deliberation of the various parts of the bill have been outlined in our written report. The administration plans to move certain CSAs to certain provisions. The Bills Committee does not have any objection to these CSAs and will not move any CSAs in its name. President, this is my personal view of the bill. DAB and myself, I have no objection to the content of this bill, and we will support the bill. and the CSAs moved by the administration. Having said that, and on the legal drafting division of the DFJ, when they present such omnibus bills to the electrical, i.e., proposed amendments to technical miscellaneous amendments to various ordinances. Well, this is called the Statute Law Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014. And it contains 15 parts, 173 clauses, and it straddles various policy areas, including homosexuals' equality, EOC, land tribunal, members' power, and the related arrangements of the various organizations, and the admissibility of evidence in various courts, delivery notice of service of notice of communications authority, and also the amendments to the Building Maintenance Ordinance, allowing written statements to replace oaths, and also proposals made by the Law Society, and many other more provisions, and also making consistent the names, the Chinese names of the Director of Commission of Excise and Customs, and Assistant Commissioner, and so on. So these areas are sort of unrelated, and this is a kind of omnibus bill straddling a wide portfolio of work areas. So that brings problems when we scrutinize the bill. Why did I say so? Because, well, we've got 70 members, and we came from different backgrounds, and we have different concerns. This kind of omnibus bill straddling so many areas will create difficulties for members, well, who may not be well-versed in all the areas to be discussed. So this poses a problem. Of course, I understand that the content of this bill really has to do with technical amendments, and I hope that in the future, the legal drafting section of the DFJ can avoid presenting such a kind of miscellaneous bill, so to speak. And this will, if they refrain from doing so, then it will help us in scrutinizing bills. So we support the bill. Does any other member wish to speak?
Mr. Ray Chan. Well, in relation to the Statute Law Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014, Part 2, that is, Crimes Ordinance and Section 118 in relation to homosexual sex crimes, I would like to speak. Because when it comes to the very the offences related to homosexuality, well, actually, all these are based on those laws enacted in 1956, and all of them are outdated in nowadays Hong Kong. They are discriminatory, conflicting, and there are many other examples where one can criticize it. According to the administration, this is a technical amendment, and I would like to talk about 118C. You might have heard of an offense that's called unlawful sexual intercourse with a girl under 16. What it means is that, well, the consensual age for heterosexual relationship is 16, and it's Section 124 of the Crimes Ordinance. Any male who has a sexual intercourse with a girl under 16, it commits an offence, and the penalty is 5 years imprisonment. However, when it comes to a sexual intercourse between a male and a male, what is the consensual age? So far, as at today, a lot of Hong Kong people don't even know. According to the law, Crimes Ordinance, Section 118C, buggery with a male under 21 commits an offence, and it can attract a life sentence, and that is the offence. However, in 2004, the High Court judged on a case that this involves a sex discrimination and is a contravention of the Hong Kong Basic Law and the Bills of Rights, so it's unconstitutional. And even after that, The administration lodged an appeal, and the appeal was quashed in 2005, and then it was left as that. According to case law, for male and male sexual intercourse, the age of consent is 16, just like with a female. However, it's been many years when the law hasn't been changed. And as a result, everyone is in the dark. And people thought that the age of consent was 21 if it's between a male and another male. We complain. However, the police invoked this unconstitutional provision to charge a defendant. Although, yes, the administration said that, they have not. There was no successful prosecution. However, you use this outdated piece of legislation to charge someone. Of course, it will not be prosecuted in the end. It won't go to that. It won't go to that stage, because the court will not allow that. The process hurt those involved. And on a number of occasions, I remind the Security Bureau, I remind the police that they have to be very careful when it comes to enforcement of the law. I hope this will be the last occasion when I speak on this, because after the third reading of this bill, the law is changed finally. The age 21 will be changed to 16, which is the same age as the in a heterosexual sexual intercourse. And from the court's judgment, to now, a lot of gay people still don't know whether it's 16, 18, or 21 when it's lawful to have a sexual intercourse. Some people claim that they are under 21 and they blackmail their gay partner, saying that, well, you have to give me gifts, give me money, otherwise I'll go to the police. And the victim thought that the law still states that you have to be 21. And as a result, they succumbed to the threat and they were put under stress and they were extorted. They didn't even know that they were victims. They did not break the law. Yes, the piece of legislation has been declared unconstitutional and is invalid. It's been 9 years when action has been taken to change the law. And homosexual people don't even know what is going on. And my ward office has received a lot of inquiries, requests for assistance. I asked the administration how come they have dragged their feet for 9 years. The Security Bureau passed the buck to the Law Reform Commission. They said that it has to be amended together with all other relevant legislation. However, it has taken the Law Reform Commission a long time to complete their review. And this time, the administration make use of this statute law, Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014, and include this piece of legislation, at least change the age from 21 to 16. And in relation to the review on sex-related offences, there are three consultation papers. The first one was announced in September 2012. And it was done by a subcommittee of the sex-related offences of the LRC. When will we see the other two consultation papers? Don't know. How long do we have to wait? 10, 20 years? Still, no one can answer you. No one dare give you an answer. The SB or the and the Department of Justice can't answer you. And I can only say that this is patchwork with good intentions. It's better than not doing anything. And this one is a perfect example of pocketed first. But still, it's still neither here nor there. Say, for example, illegal sexual intercourse with a girl aged under 16. Maximum penalty is 5 years of imprisonment. However, for Section 118C, age is changed to 16. So unlawful sexual intercourse with a male age under 16, the maximum penalty is a life sentence. So you can see the difference with a girl, 5 years, with a guy, life imprisonment. So it's discriminating. According to statistics of the administration, unlawful sexual intercourse with the same age, the penalty is a lot higher. Imprisonment rate is about 54%, with the length of imprisonment from 9 months to 9 years. But with the opposite sex, it's only 11.7%, with a length of sentence spanning from 3 months to 6 years only. So one out of every two homosexual people has to go straight to prison. So is there discrimination based on sexual orientation? Yes, on facts and on convictions. However, there is no comparable certain sexual related offenses with the other sex. Say, for example, woman 8, F, and J. Now, only woman 8F and woman FJ bracket 2A has been taken away. 118G and K and gross indecency. 118HIJK. There is no corresponding offenses when it comes to heterosexual heterosexual offenses. For 118F, that is, homosexual buggery committed otherwise than in private, and 118J, gross indecency with or by man. However, only 118F is repealed, not the other one. It's controversial. If someone takes out a judicial review, according to the proportionality, the administration is going to lose. 118J is repealed, and in effect, 118J, the penalty of 2 years will be replaced by gross indecency, by outraging public decency, which attracts a penalty of 7 years imprisonment. So, if this is taken away, then attracts a higher term of imprisonment, which is 7 years instead of 2 years. And I think it's just an excuse on the part of the administration. They just want to threaten us. I believe that if there is no 118J, you will use the offense of outraging public decency. Now that 118F has been taken away, that is homosexual buggery otherwise than in public, does it mean that 118J can be changed? If that is the case, then it's a continuation of sexual sex discrimination ordinance. And it's just to scare us that it should not be changed because it will be worse. It's discrimination on the grounds of sexual orientation, because in a heterosexual case, there is no corresponding offense. Why do you use these offenses to charge homosexual people, say, for example, gross indecency? This is discrimination against homosexual people and heterosexual people as well, because for homosexual, for male-male, it's now changed to 16. However, in 118D, buggery with a girl under 28, under 21 is an offense and is a life. So for male-male, it's 16, male-female still buggery, and it's 21. And so you see, there is a different standard. So when it comes to the law reform on sex-related offences, it's urgent. What the administration doesn't want to do is to take action. Well, they have no choice when there is a court case. What they can only do is to drag their feet. And they took the chance of the statute law miscellaneous provisions bill to do something reluctantly. I know that for some officials, they did it with good intentions, at least, because if I do it this way, at least there is a change. However, for those offences that are not declared unconstitutional, yet they have not been, there is no such declaration because there is no such case. And if indeed there is a case, then the administration will lose. For those, the administration doesn't do anything. And it's just like if you use the LRC, it's just like putting these matters into a black hole because the LegCo cannot pressure the LRC to deliver within, say, 3 or 5 years. So let me reiterate. In 2012 September, the LRC issued rape and other non-consensual sexual offences consultation paper. And they proposed repealing 118A. However, there is still a need for public consultation. In a meeting, I asked, well, about these 3 steps of the LRC, when will it complete? The administration answer really took me by surprise. It said that because of the wide scope of issues, the LRC said that it is impracticable to set a deadline. We've been waiting for 9 years, and for an offence that's been declared unconstitutional, and it's only today when we see the third reading. So I appeal to Hong Kong people, homosexual or heterosexual, police, to be aware of this fact. The male-male sexual intercourse, the age is 21 and not 16, but there should be an overall review. Does any other member wish to speak?
If not, then I call upon the Secretary for Justice to reply. The debate will come to a close after the Secretary has replied. The Secretary for Justice. Since the introduction of the Statute Law Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014 into the Legislative Council in April this year, 4 Bills Committee meetings have been held. The Bills Committee, chaired by the Honourable Tam Yiu-chung, has thoroughly examined the clauses and the issues involved. I would like to express my gratitude to the Honourable Tam Yiu-chung and all the members of the Bills Committee for their hard work and valuable opinions. As I pointed out when introducing the bill into the Legislative Council, the bill seeks to propose technical and, in our view, non-controversial amendments to various ordinances for the purpose of updating or improving the relevant existing legislation.
The bill comprises 15 parts and deals with miscellaneous amendments proposed by bureaus and the Department of Justice in a consolidated manner. The proposed amendments in the bill fall roughly into 3 categories. The first category of amendments are those proposed by the relevant bureaus in the light of court rulings, including amendments to certain sexual offence provisions in the Crimes Ordinance and certain defence provisions in the Trade Descriptions Ordinance. The second category of amendments in the bill aim to implement proposals put forward by individual bodies and organizations. They include the various miscellaneous amendments to the 4 anti-discrimination ordinances proposed by the EOC, the amendments to the evidence ordinance suggested by the Hong Kong Society of Notaries relating to admissibility of notarial instruments, and then amendments to Section 8A of the Legal Practitioners Ordinance in response to the Law Society's proposals, and the amendments to Section 7 and Schedule 2 of the Building Management Ordinance so as to implement one of the proposals of the interim report of the Review Committee on the Building Management Ordinance. The third category concerns miscellaneous and technical amendments to various ordinances or subsidiary legislation proposed for different purposes, mainly by the DOFJ and other relevant bureaus. I will be moving some amendments at the committee stage later. These amendments have all been agreed by the Bills Committee and can be grouped into the following six categories, which I will outline briefly below. Amendment to Clause 43 of Part 4. Clause 43 proposes to amend Section 81 of the Evidence Ordinance, Cap 8. However, after the gazetto of the bill, amendments to Section 81 of the Evidence Ordinance have also been proposed under Clause 13 of the Competition Amendment Bill 2014. The Competition Amendment Bill was passed before the bill was gazetted as an ordinance on the 21st of November 2014. With reference to the latest version of Section 81 of the Evidence Ordinance, I will propose a CSA to Clause 43 of the bill in order to ensure that the proposed amendments will be properly effected. Deletion of Part 10. The proposed amendment in Part 10 of the bill, which seeks to repeal Item 29 of Schedule 1 to the Legal Services Legislation Miscellaneous Amendments Ordinance 1997-94 of 1997, was suggested by the Law Society. The policy intent is to reinstate the law prior to the above 1997 ordinance so that only solicitors or foreign lawyers could become trustees or co-trustees of a trust. In view of the views expressed by the AGLS panel, the administration consulted the Law Society further on a number of occasions about the policy intent. The Law Society subsequently confirmed in May 2014 that as the proposed amendment in Part 10 might not achieve the intended objective, they would not pursue the proposed amendment. I will therefore move a CSA to delete Part 10 of the bill. Amendment to Clause 63 of Part 12. Having regard to the Company's Ordinance, Cap 622, which came into operation on the 3rd of March this year, I will propose a CSA to Clause 63 to add the entry of Registrar of Companies specified for the purposes of the Company's Ordinance to the proposed schedule to the specification of public officers' notice. Addition of Division 5 in Part 12 with consequential amendment to Clause 1, 2 and addition of Clause 1, 5. To follow on a consequential amendment that was omitted in previous amendment exercises, the opportunity is taken to add the entry of Secretary for Home Affairs specified for the purposes of the Box Registration Ordinance to the existing specification of public officers, Cap 1 Subsidiary Legislation C by way of CSA. The amendment is deemed to have come into operation on the 9th of April 1998. Addition of Division 47A and 47B and replacement of Division 53 by the new Divisions 53 to 55 in Part 14. After the gazetto of the bill, four new regulations have been enacted under Section 3 of the UN Sanctions Ordinance, Cap 537. I will propose CSAs to add the new Divisions 47A and 47B and to replace Division 53 by the new Divisions 53 to 55 in Part 14 in order to amend the definitions of Commissioner in the Chinese tax of the regulations concerned by removing the references to Hong Kong in Hong Kong Hai Guan Guan Zhang, Hong Kong Hai Guan Fu Guan Zhang, and Hong Kong Hai Guan Zhou Li Guan Zhang. Amendments to clauses 1, 3, 14, 2, 48, 3, 51, 52, 2, 54, 64, and 68, 2A. These technical amendments in the bill seek to refine the provisions. President, with these remarks, I urge members to support the second reading of the Statute Law Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014 and endorse all the amendments to be moved by the administration at the subsequent committee stage. Thank you. I now put a question to you, and that is that the Statute Law Miscellaneous Provisions Bill 2014 be read a second time. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Mr. Chen Qiqun claims a division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
现在开始投票。
Voting begins. Please check your vote. If there is no problem, voting is now closed. Display of results. 44 present, 43 for, 0 against, 0 abstention. I declare the motion. I think the question is agreed by a majority of the members present. I declare motion passed. Statute law miscellaneous provisions, Bill 2014, committee stage. Council is now in committee.